Hello everyone, this is Mutant Nuts and today we'll be continuing with our beginner friendly road to OSCP video series. And today we'll be looking at another Hack the Box machine, that is Optimum. And Optimum is a Windows machine and it is rated as easy. To get the initial foothold in this box, you can do it by two ways. That is manual exploitation as well as using a Python script. So we'll be looking at both today because it is always good to know and do things manually because sometimes the scripts don't work. In this case, the script works, 100%, but then I still want to show it in the manual way, like how it is done. Okay, so let's just quickly get started. So first, what I always do is I run an auto recon scan. Okay, so I'll be giving the sudo command for it because I'm gonna run it as root since I'm running the OS as Kali, and you have to run it as Python 3. So we'll give the auto recon directory, which is over here where the file is present. We'll give the target IP address, that is 10.10.10.8 in Optimum's case. We'll be giving the O switch for output, and we'll be giving the directory where you want to save the entire scan results. So I did already execute this scan, so I don't want to do it again because it takes some time. So let's just quickly look at the scan results, and we see that there is only one port open, that is port 80. Okay, so port 80 is open and it is running HTTP service and the version is HTTP file servers. So it looks like it is running a file server which is based on HTTP. Okay, and the version number is this. So let's just quickly go and look into the web page. Then we come across this, okay, there's a search bar, there's like select or actions or something, and there's a login page, press home, I don't think anything happens. You press login, it asks for a user ID and password. Okay, so I'll just quickly press, okay, unauthorized. So let's just go back. Okay, so now we are over here, and we see that, there are a few things probably you can try manually over here. What we can do is, we go to search exploit. Okay, so we'll search exploit and we'll check for okay, so the entire file name present over here, it's HTTP file server 2.3. So let's just quickly enter this and see if we get something. And we have multiple entries over here. It says Regito. So if you try and click this, it is actually from Regito, right? Okay. So let's just quickly just take this and try to search using HFS only. HFS, so that we get less results, right? So we got few results over here. It says Regito HTTP file server, remote code execution. Okay, this is using Metasploit, we don't want to do that. Then there is for 2.3 version, so we can further check only 2.3. So there's an arbitrary file upload and there's remote code execution. And there are two remote code execution. Okay, so this is the one which I'm the manual way which I will be looking at first, and this is the Python script which we can just execute and add few values over there and we get our initial shell. So let's just quickly look at this. So what we'll do is we'll use search exploit and we'll use the M switch. So what the M switch does is basically just quickly it will copy it in our current working directory. Okay, so it came over here, so let's just quickly go back, look at exploit, and we see that it says that there is some issue in poor regex in the file, so it will not handle null bytes. So a request to will not stop regex from passing the macro, and the macro will be executed and remote code injection would take place. Okay, so basically it says that probably this line of URL, okay, so this is vulnerable, the search command is vulnerable over here. And it says the local host port 80 because probably he might have tried to do the POC on the POC in the local host. So our IP address is this, right? So let's just quickly try and type something on the command. Okay, so this is the URL which we are looking for. Okay, it actually says the same thing. Okay, the search URL. So this is where I think the search command is vulnerable. And now what we'll do is we'll just take it to burp suite. And you have to modify the script. I have already set it up, so you will have no proxy, right, by default. So you just put it as manual proxy, use this for your localhost IP and this port number, and you set the Firefox over here and then go and burp. So burp itself again has the same thing present, it's by default present, so make sure it's running. Let's just quickly go and clear this. clear history, yes. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll try, okay, this thing search command is right. Let's just reload it again. And we'll look at a burp request. So you guys may be knowing, right, what burp is about now, because burp proxy, what it's doing. So it says over here, burp proxy. So whatever connections we are making first it will go over here from our web browser. It will go to burp in our system, that is over here. And from burp, it will then get forwarded over here. Okay, and same request which will come can come over here, and then it will come over here. So this is how the proxy will work. Otherwise, if we would have not added in a Firefox, there are no proxy option. So it will just go directly and come back directly. Okay, so this is how it actually works over here. So let's just look at a search command. So this is what we want to look at. We'll look at the response. I don't see anything useful over here. So let's just quickly go and take it to repeater. Repeater, basically, you know, we can try and test out things over here. So this is one particular exploit where probably repeater is very useful. Like, you know, you can, you will probably come to know how it actually works. So we have the search command, which is mutated nuts. And we need something like this. Okay, probably to check if it is vulnerable. So just take, copy it, and paste it over here. Okay, and probably it says CMD, so I think you have to enter your command over here. So let's just try who am I first. Let's see if we get some response, like who am I. Okay, it's a long list. Probably we can just search over here if we have any command. Who am I? Okay, just this thing for the ID. Okay. I don't think we have any thing present over here, like, you know, because it's a blind injection, like, you know, you're entering a command, but you cannot see the output over here. So that means it is blind to us. So in this, we cannot see. So whenever we want to test remote command injection, what we do is, first thing, I always do that, and it is very well recommended. First, start a TCP dump, sudo and TCP dump. You have to run it as root, TCP dump. So I'll give the I switch, and I'll be giving tunnel 0 because that's where my VPN is connected, tunnel 0. And I'll be giving the ICMP this, like, because I want to sniff only ICMP packets. Okay, I entered my password wrong. Okay, so we have this TCP dump working. So TCP dump is basically like Wireshark. So in your Kali system over here, it's going to sniff for packets. So whichever packets are coming into our system, right? Many packets may be going in the back end. But if we start TCP dump, it will list out all the packets over coming over here. So let's just quickly go and try and ping our system and see if we get something. So we'll just do ping, and we'll do 10.10. That is my system's IP, like attack machine's IP. So we'll just URL encode it, because since it is an HTTP request, if you don't URL encode, I'll just show you all what happens if you want to remove the URL encoding. So we'll just do this. Okay, we'll see that later probably, but first we'll just URL encode it and we'll send it. And we see that we do not have anything coming over here, right? There is nothing present over here. So what we'll do is, so we'll just quickly take this off and turn 0. That's it. And let's just listen now and see if we get something. And see, we have a remote code execution looks like. See, if you see this particular command over here, it clearly says that there is one. First, we obviously send a request, right, to burp suit over here. Then we get a response over here, I guess. So later on, it starts sending response. That is a ping command. So ping, it sends like 4 times, right? So 1, 2, 3, 4 on Windows system. So that means this is our target IP address over here, if you guys can see, and it is sending through port 80, right? So this is what it is coming over here, and we are getting it over here in this particular port and on our attack machine. So that's why I think so when we enter ICMP only, this particular, you know, packet does not come over here. Okay, so what we'll do next is, I'll just show you all how URL encoding will affect us over here if we do this. Okay, for some reason, I don't know, we still got the ping. And I'll just, okay, fine. So, see, if you see the color coding over here, that this particular, it actually considers this packet, but I don't know, for some reason, it gave us a ping. And there's a space, right? So that means there's a break. And then this particular data is present over here. So ideally it should not work, but for some reason it worked over there. But so now what we'll do, since we are aware that, you know, ping packet is coming, and why is that ICMP not coming? Is because, sorry. So let's just try one thing. We'll try PowerShell and, you know, to see, because PowerShell, I don't know, I think this thing is using that HFS server, right, to execute commands. So let's just use PowerShell and we'll give the ping command. Because the system is Windows, right, so we obviously will be using PowerShell. So let's just close this and use ICMP, okay. And now we'll URL encode it, that is control U, okay, and we'll send it. And we see that we get a ICMP request, response and everything, right, over here. Okay, so that means we got our request response, and that another thing is that it successfully executed PowerShell commands. Okay, so now what we'll do is, since we have execution of PowerShell, we can add a reverse shell over here, right? We can use that IEX command to add a reverse shell. So first thing, what you will do is, you need a PowerShell reverse shell. Okay, so if you guys want to know where to download this form, I think you can get it on GitHub. You can go over here, probably in this directory. Go to shells. And this is the one which we are looking for, the TCP one, okay? So just go and download that. Well, probably you can download the entire folder because it's very useful, like there are different shells or something. So if you just open this, and you don't have to see much over here, it's just basically a PowerShell reverse shell. And this is the function that is invoke PowerShell TCP, okay? So the example, the usage is given over here. It says that invoke PowerShell reverse, shell. An IP address, and this is where we have to enter our IP address and port number. So we'll just take this, copy it, and paste it over here. Now what we'll do is, we'll just modify this IP address to my system's IP address, because it's a reverse shell, right? From target machine, it has to come to attack machine, right? From this machine, it has to come to over here. So it needs an address. Without address, you wouldn't be able to come. Okay, so 1420, and we'll give the port number as, okay, probably just give 4444, okay, and we'll save it. Now the reason why we are adding this in the end is, this function over here which is present, we need to call it, right? Somebody has to call it. This is just a function, it wouldn't execute itself. So the function has to be called, and probably we have to enter this parameters over here. So if you guys quickly look at this function present over here, if this function is present, which says print hello world, inside the function it's like printf hello world, okay, but it will not execute it by them, like, you know, on its own it's not going to execute. So you have to call that particular function, then only it will get executed. So same thing we are doing. So once the script is loaded in our PowerShell, in our target machine's PowerShell, in the end it will just run this command. That means it will execute this entire script, so we don't have to manually enter this, you know, command again in PowerShell. Okay, so what we'll do is, we'll go to burp, and probably we'll use PowerShell exe, I'll just clear this off, and we'll be using the IEX command, so that is invoke expression. So invoke expression, you have to create an object basically in your PowerShell, you know, in the memory, it will load this particular, this function, okay, and so that's how we'll be able to call it. So let's just go quickly and look at it. New object, net web client. So this is the syntax which we have to use. You have to create a new object that is net web client, and we'll be giving download string, and we'll be giving the HTTP address, that is 14.20 port 8000, and we'll be giving the file name as, okay, and we'll close this. So we have PowerShell and we need to execute this command. So we'll just give the C switch. Okay, we'll give this parameter over here, another param, this, sorry, quotes over here, so that we close it. and we'll just URL encode it. Okay, so before sending this request, what we'll do is we'll quickly go and we'll actually shut this. We don't need this anymore. And we see we have that invoke PowerShell TCP present over here, right? So we'll Python M. So we need two things now. First, we need to set up a HTTP server. And other thing is we need to set up a listener. Okay, so we'll listen at NVLP port 444. Why 444? Because in our script over here, in the end, we have given port 444, right? That's why we need to have it on. So Python M HTTP server on port 8000. Why 8000? Okay. Sorry, we have to get Python 3. Okay. So why 8000? Because we are writing 8000. We can give any port and then, you know, modify the changes over here. So let's just send and see what happens. So it got a file present over here, and see, we have some netcat connection coming, right? It says like Windows PowerShell running as Costas. So if you do, who am I? We are in the system as Costas. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll just quickly go and see. We are in the desktop itself. So we'll just do directory, and we have our user text present over here. So it's very well readable. You guys can probably go and, you know, get the flag from here. Other thing is, now what we'll do, so this is the first way how you execute this particular, you know, initial foothold. And this is the manual way where we got to know that, you know, probably we'll use burp and then probably use PowerShell and to command execute and do things. So we'll look at another way now. Okay, so that will be the same way probably, because we don't need that, just close this. So this is going to be the POC script which we saw, the Python script earlier. I'll just quickly show y'all. So exploit HFS 23. Okay, so this one I'm talking about. Okay, so let's just quickly get it. So exploit M. Okay, so it's copied over here. Let's just check it out. And it does the same thing. It basically does the same thing on the search command, right? If you guys read the script over here, it's doing the same thing on the search command. It's, you know, probably using this and adding some command execution over here, but it's automating everything for us. But always try and prefer and, you know, check out more pages and to solve the boxes or something, or solve some exploit, because you get to learn manual ways, and manual ways are always good, because sometimes when you're stuck up in some script, okay, it's not executing. So you can troubleshoot using the manual way if you guys know, and probably learn multiple things over here. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll just try and use this exploit. So we'll just do okay, we'll just try and use it first and just do 39161.py. And it says that obviously you have to enter some target IP, local IP, and everything you have to change over here. So let's just go to our script. And it says, you always use the, you know, read the description present over there, or the usage. It says that you can use this. Okay, this is probably for the HFS server. And for the usage, you have to enter Python, okay, the exploit over here. And then you have to give your target IP address, that is 10.10.10.8. And the target port number, that will be 80. And it says you need to be using a web server hosting netcat on this particular IP address. Okay, so attacker's IP address, that means our local host. Okay, like our system attack machine on port 80, but you have to host it on port 80, because probably, you know, here they have written something like port 80 or something like that. So we have to have a netcat listener present over here. Okay, so, okay, fine. So now I think we need a netcat listener first. So what we'll do is we'll just quickly look at nc.exe, locate it. It's already present in our Windows box over here. So you can just take it, copy over here, lsla. We'll give the permission, okay. chmod 777 nc.exe, just full permission, because to execute things right. Now what we'll do is we'll set up a nc VLP on port 444. Okay, we'll go to our script. We have the netcat over here present. We have to set up a HTTP server, right? So that means, how will we do that? We'll be doing it using obviously the Python 3. Okay, it's done earlier. Okay, so we'll do that, but now we'll be doing it on port 80. So if I try to do this, it will not let me. So you have to use it as sudo. Okay, so now it's running. So I've done this, and now what the next step? You have to try and modify the script over here. So if you guys can see, local IP address, local port number. So this is not my IP address, right? So the local IP address, that means the attack machine IP address, your system's IP address, that is 10.10.14.20. Okay, so now next thing what we'll do is, I'll just quickly go and change the port number. So that is local port where you want to listen on port 4444. Okay, so I'll just save it, do nothing. Okay, and probably, let's say Python. Okay, so we'll just quickly go and try and execute the script now. Python 391.61.py, and first thing was, you give your target machine's IP address, right? It says our target IP address and the port number. So target IP address 8 and the port number, that is 80. So it did run, but I don't know, for some reason did not give us a shell over here. So if you guys read the next line as well, it says that you may need to run it multiple times for success. Okay, let's just try it out. It's always good to, you know, try and execute the file again and see what happens. So see, now I think once it called for the netcat file, right? So somehow that did not execute well. And now it says that we are in the system over here. And I do, who am I? It says Costas. So that means we are in the system as Costas. Same thing what we saw earlier in the manual expectation, it does the same thing. But if you see, we are over here as CMD. So if we just do help, and we see over here we are in command line. We are not in PowerShell. So command line is basically where, you know, a few things are very restricted. So now we'll be looking at the privilege escalation part, and we'll be using the first manual method, because if you guys see that we entered the system as CMD and options are limited. So we use the manual method over here, right? This PowerShell command over here which worked, right? So we'll just try and get the shell first, and we'll see how to privilege escalate. Wait for some time. Okay, sorry, we need to have our listeners present over here. Yep, so we got the connection. Probably just wait for the shell to load. Okay, so we are in the system over here as user Costas. Let's just go back. First thing to do is check for who am I. But probably do not find anything useful over here, so let's just do system info. You know, we'll get all the system information present over. We see like a lot of hotfixes present, and we see that OS number, that is OS name, sorry, Windows Server 2012 R2. The OS version is this, and okay, it is an x64 based system, that means 64 bit system, and we have yeah, that's it. And there are multiple hotfixes present. Okay, so what we'll do is, first thing, we'll just quickly take this Windows server, right? So we'll just go to search exploit, and we'll quickly see if there is any exploit or something available for that. So let's just quickly, I don't think we need this anymore. So just close this. Search exploit. Okay, I think I'll do it in a new. Exploit 2012 R2, because this is what the server was, and we see that we have multiple vulnerabilities, you know, like some few exploits present over here. With this one says like SMB remote code execution, eternal blue. So we don't have SMB running, right? So I don't think this would any which way work. This also said SMB, and this also says SMB. So all these three, I think we would skip it. Now this one, what we are looking for over here, it says local privilege escalation using PowerShell. So probably we need PowerShell for that, and we'll just try and get this script in our folder. So we'll just use exploit mswitch, and so it is copied over here. So let's just look at the script. So this is the script which we are looking for. says that implementation of, I think this is the vulnerability. You guys can probably go and read about this vulnerability if required. It says about some race condition. In order to, for the race condition to succeed, the machine must have 2+ CPU cores. That means the machine should have 2 CPU cores. And if testing in a VM, make sure to add a core if needed. Okay. Okay, fine. So this is what it looks like, and it says that it is tested on 32-bit Windows 7, 64-bit Windows 8, and 64-bit 2K12R2, that is 2012R2. So now in our system, we already have this, copied, and we already have 64-bit present. So let's just quickly go and check if we can use this particular exploit. So if we look at the usage over here, it says something like, there is CMD over here that it's been calling, probably it's calling some process, and again it's calling CMD over here. There are 2 CMDs present over here. So first, we'll not modify anything. As always, for running PowerShell, in order to execute it in the end, what we'll do is we'll try and run this function again in the end. Okay, same thing what we saw over here. So we have the function, we are calling it again. So as soon as it loads up, so we'll be calling that function. So we'll be doing that. So over here, since we are already named PowerShell, we'll do IEX, and we need a Python server up and running, IEX. And what we do is, okay, new object, net web client, okay, download string, HTTP, okay, 1000, and our file name, that is, okay, let's just rename this file to this for better view. Okay. So what this command, obviously, like we saw in the burpsuit as well, it's creating a new object, net web client, downloading the string, that is whatever is present over here, and it'll probably load in the PowerShell's memory, okay, and it'll execute the command in the end. But it says like no valid thread handle was captured exiting or something like that. It says operating system core count is 2. That means it is successful. We have sufficient cores present over here. But for some reason, this exploit does not work over here. For some reason. So what we'll do is, we are running PowerShell over here. The PowerShell which is running by default, it is running as 32-bit. 32-bit PowerShell is running. So we need to run the PowerShell as 64-bit. So in order to do that, we have to use a directory which is C, Windows, PowerShell. Okay, I think it's this native first. It's native PowerShell. Okay, sorry, Windows PowerShell. Windows PowerShell. It's v1.0 PowerShell.exe. Command, and we'll give the command as, okay, we'll just give PowerShell.exe. Who am I? Just try this. And it says we are in over here as Costas. So this is how we are going to use it. We need this sysnative, that is the 64-bit version of PowerShell, in order to execute this command properly. Okay, so what we'll do is, first we'll take and copy this, and then we'll take and copy this command which we had entered earlier, right? We'll see what happens. It says it got the file, probably loading it in the memory and trying to execute it or something. For some reason, it is stuck. Not sure why. Okay, I think we probably have to enter the command switch. Okay, I'm thinking that froze up. Okay, let's just quickly send this again. Okay, we have a shell. Okay, so we'll use this again. And then we'll be using the C switch, because which we forgot earlier, right? So this, so we have to enter the C switch for command to be executed, because it's a very big long command. So we enter this and then press enter. Okay, so we got the file over here, and it says operating system core count 2, duplicating something done using thread handle, something like that, sniffing out privileged impersonation token. Okay, so again, it's impersonating, trying to get a system token. It got a system token. Somehow it says that we have a system shell. So let's see, who are we in the system as? Oh, we are still as Costas. So we are not as system as of now. So if we probably go and look at the script again, it tries to do, what it tries to do is it tries to start a process. So basically it tries to execute and open a CMD inside a CMD. Okay, so what it basically does is this particular command. Okay, I'll just show you all quickly. So first, this is our normal PowerShell, right? PowerShell which is working. So now what it will try to do is, it will, once that CMD command is executed, right, this one over here, not the first one, because the first one it uses to create some thread or something, because I manually tried it. So if you enter some, you know, change this, it probably, the script wouldn't work. So in order to get that particular token or thread, it uses the CMD over here. Then what it does is it creates another CMD over here, this particular command. But this is only useful probably if you have a GUI access. That means if you have system access, like how I have it on this box. So if I want to escalate my privilege from the user Kali to sudo, so that means root, sorry. So that means I'll be using this command on my Windows machine and I'll be executing it. Like locally I'll do it with all the GUI and all present. But since we have only command line interface present over here, so probably we'll have to modify the script somehow. So what we'll do is, first thing, we'll try and go to our temp directory, that is cd windows temp. Okay, so we are in temp directory now. Oops, it says string get child item. Okay, since we have already, you know, tried to call that PowerShell script, so that's why probably it's not okay. Okay, so what we'll do is quickly we'll just go and copy, and okay, we don't have access to this path for some reason, so we'll just go cd public. Okay, here cd users, here cd public. Yeah, okay, so see, the POC script, it actually created a few files over here. So we'll just try and create a file over here. Okay, so what we'll do is, first we'll try and create a MSF Venom reverse shell. Why MSF Venom reverse shell is because our Kali system is present over here, right? Since we already have access, we don't need this particular thing anymore, this PowerShell, because it will work only if you have a GUI present. So now we already got remote command execution over here. We are in the system as Costas, right? We are getting our reverse shell and everything coming up over here. Now we are locally present in the system. We want to escalate our privileges. So what we'll do is, and since this command is just getting one CMD on top of other, so we'll try and create a reverse shell present over here. First, we'll create a reverse shell, reverse.exe. Okay, we'll create this reverse shell. We'll, you know, try and put it over here using SMB. We'll try and send it over using SMB. And once it is present in this particular folder over the public folder, then we'll try and execute this reverse shell using this command over here. Okay. So first thing, what we'll do is we'll just try and modify this command. Since there are two CMD commands on top and down. Top one it used to get the system shell probably. And the down one is the actual command which it will run. So what we'll do is we'll enter users, then public, and we'll enter the file name. Okay, that is reverse exe. So we did this, but we just modified the command, right? Now we need to create it as well. So we'll use MSF Venom for that, and we'll be creating a payload that is Windows x64 now, because it's a 64-bit system, and shell reverse tcp, give the L host as 1420 and L port as 5555 because we already in port 444, right? So we'll use this. We want the file type as exe and we'll be giving the output switch for reverse exe because we need the same file. You probably can give any name over here and then, but you have to modify the script as well over here. Okay, so we give this, just press enter. It takes some time to load. So we'll just quickly go and I don't think we require, okay, we require this thing. So we'll just quickly start a SMB server over here. So we'll do sudo impacket SMB server and we'll give the name as kindly subscribe and we'll begin the directory location. That is this, okay. You require sudo permission to start this impacket SMB server. So what we'll do is, what the SMB server is probably doing, we have this reverse shell over here, right? It is present over here now. So we're trying and sending it over here. So for that, we are using SMB because SMB, it will try and people can access anything, whatever is present in our SMB folder over here. So we'll try and send this over here and using this PowerShell command, we'll try and execute this particular reverse shell. So we'll just see how it quickly works. Okay, so what we'll do, just copy this thing now. Copy 10.10.20. CXC. We got some request and it has been copied, I guess. If you do dir and you see that reverse is present over here. Okay, so now we have all the things present. First, we completed adding this, you know, reverse thing over here. We modified the payload, the reverse shell, and then okay, I think okay, we have to modify it over here. Users public because that file I just renamed that file, right? So this earlier file was present and open, so probably that's how it did not work. Okay, it wouldn't work. So we need this file present over here because we'll be calling it over here in the system. Okay, so now we have this file present, the reverse file, and we'll be calling our system, that the PowerShell script which we had executed earlier, right? This particular script, just copy paste it. Okay, and before that, what we'll do, we'll just start our netcat listener on port 5555, because in our reverse shell which we have created over here, we have given the port as 555. Okay, so we'll just take this, paste it. Why we are pasting it, this particular line over here? Because we need the PowerShell x64 bit, okay? Sorry, the 64 bit one, we need it over here. So we'll be giving the C switch for the command. We'll be using invoke expression to get this invoke MS1632PS1 file, where it will redirect it. It will say that, hey, you know what? This command is there, so we need to execute this reverse exe file. So that means this command will get the system token, like an administrator token, and it will use that token to execute and run this file. Okay, so let's just see if it works. It got the request and see, we have a shell over here, and if we do who am I, and we see that we are in the system as system. So if we do users, sorry, so we are inside as administrator. So we do desktop. Okay, so we are in the system over here and we get, obviously we can go and, you know, type this root text over here. So this is how you gain access to the system. So just to get a quick recap on what happened. So first we have this MS16. So we have this PS1 file present over here, right? And now we are over here in the Optimum system. We have local command injection, and we have the shell as user costers. So first, what it will do, we will try and execute an IEX command to get this particular file, this PS1 file. We have to get this file, and this is hosted on the HTTP server on our Kali machine, attack machine. We will get this PS1 file over here. Once this PS1 file comes, we have modified the PS1 file, right? So that it executes this particular file present over here. And we have created a reverse shell. So earlier, before this executing this file, we had sent our reverse shell over here using SMB. So this reverse.exe file is already present over here. So now, when you execute this, you get this PS1 file over here. It loads up in the PowerShell's memory over here. Now what it will do is, it will look for this particular file present over here. See users public reverse. And once it looks for this file, it'll be like, hey, you know what, I have to execute you using the system token. So it will check the system token over here. System token, and it will execute this file. And what this file will do is, it will basically just send us a reverse shell to our netcat listener over here. So if we have netcat present over here, it will just send us a reverse shell, and we are in the system as system. Okay, so this is how the whole exploit works. And I guess, so if you guys like the video, give a thumbs up, and also subscribe for more interesting and upcoming videos. Okay, thank you.